In this video, we learn about the abnormal puerperium. The most important thing in the abnormal puerperium is the puerperal pyrexia. The definition of the puerperal pyrexia is the increase in temperature, that is mean it increase up to 100.4 degree Fahrenheit or 38 degree Celsius or more than that with two separate occasions at 24 hours apart within the first 10 days following the delivery. It means the puerperal pyrexia means what? Following the delivery, after 24 hours apart, within the 10 days is the duration. After 24 hours and within first 10 days. There may be two separate occasions occurs at 24 hours apart. The separate occasions of how much incidence? There is temperature increase of 100.4 or 38 or more than that is known as puerperal pyrexia. What are the causes behind that puerperal pyrexia? The first one is the puerperal sepsis, urinary tract infection, the mastitis, the infection of the caesarean wound, pulmonary infection, the septic pelvic thrombophlebitis, the recurrence of the Malaysia or the pulmonary TB. From this puerperal pyrexia, the one common cause is the puerperal sepsis. What is the sepsis? Sepsis means an infection. The where it occurs in the genital tract, which occurs as a complication of a delivery. The predisposing factors of this puerperal sepsis are antepartum and intrapartum. So during ANC, the disposing factors are malnutrition leads to anemia, preterm labor pain, premature rupture of the membrane, prolonged rupture of membrane, that is more than 18 hours required. During intrapartum, what factors? Repeated pervaginal examination, prolonged rupture, dehydration, trauma, hemorrhage, retained beads of placenta, placenta previa, and the caesarean wound or the caesarean section. It is very easy to learn this intrapartum. You can imagine one patient came with towards you having the abdominal pain or she is in the labor phase. So you can do the vaginal examination, but it's repeatedly occurs a ruptured of that membrane. It a prolonged rupture of membrane. Due to the rupture or the water loss, there is the dehydration. So to stabilize this dehydration, you decide to do and the caesarean section. But during this caesarean section, there may be a trauma. Now there is also a hemorrhage due to this trauma. But still, after the correction of that traumatic injury, there is also a bleeding occurs. So you can again examine the patient. You will see there is the retained beads of the placenta due to it be the placenta previa. You can learn with this also. Now the microorganisms responsible for that puerperal sepsis, the most common is aerobic or the streptococcus hemolyticus group A, while the streptococcus hemolyticus group B is affected in the infant death. Other aerobic microorganisms are staphylococcus, E. coli, chlamydia and the pseudomonas. Anaerobic are streptococcus, peptococcus and bacteriocyte. The mode of infection occurs by these microorganisms occurs by the three sites. Due to the wound infection is the most common. First one is the placental site, second one is the laceration site, the genital tract, and the third one is the wound. It may be a caesarean wound or the episiotomy wound. The sources of that infection are endogenous, autogenous and exogenous. Endogenous means the present before the delivery in the genital tract. Autogenous means elsewhere the body, that is mean on the skin or the throat. Exogenous means the infection outside sources. It means the contamination from the hospital or the attendants. The most common site of that mode of infection or the puerperal sepsis are the perineum, vagina, cervix and uterus. The wounds and lacerations occurs in these sites infect commonly. The clinical features to evaluate the puerperal sepsis. How to diagnose or how to evaluate? So we learn about the clinical features. The first one is the local infection. It means the wound. The wound become red, swollen and locally rise in the temperature. If it infected more, the temperature is increased associated with the increase in the pulse rate. Second one is the uterine infection. It is divided into two, mild and the severe. In mild case, the pulse rate is increased with the temperature. There is the lochia of offensive and the copious discharge. In severe cases, there is the pulse rate increase but no ratio with the temperature. It is associated with the chills and leads to the rigors. And the last one is the spread is occurs in the extrauterine spread, that is the pelvic peritonitis, parametritis and the pelvic abscess. To examine or to rule out the three extrauterine spread, you can examine the patient per vaginally and per abdominally. You feel the boggy mass-like structure. It is the flabby or it contain a purse-like discharge on the both fornixes. So you can diagnose, and for these you can give the antibiotic therapies or the conservative therapy. And if does not decrease with that, then you can go for the further surgical intervention. Now, what are the investigations required for that puerperal pyrexia? Before to go to the investigations, there are three principles for investigate the puerperal pyrexia. To locate the site, means to locate the infectious site, wound. Second, to identify the organisms, which we have seen previously. And third one, to assess the severity. Now, what can you do? The prophylaxis to avoid this puerperal pyrexia. As we see, the common predisposing factors are in the two groups, in the intrapartum. So the antenatal care is must during the antenatal care. Nutritional status to avoid the anemia. In the intranatal, the surgery under the aseptic precaution, the prophylactic antibiotic should be used. In the postpartum, the aseptic precautions until the wound is open of the abdomen and the vaginal care is necessary. Now you learn about to diagnose or the clinical features of that puerperal pyrexia. What about the part of the treatment? The general care, the isolation of that lady or the baby is required who is infected, adequate fluid to maintain the electrolyte balance, anemia correction if any to reduce the any further infectious pathology or to correct immediately, catheterization under the aseptic precautions, and the chart of pulse, BP, temperature, per vaginal bleeding and urine output should be maintained. And the last one is the antibiotic therapies. Antibiotic you can use as below: the gentamicin 2 mg per kg IV on the strat dose. After that, 1.5 mg per kg IV 8 hourly followed. Amphicillin 1 gram intravenously 6 hourly or the clindamycin 900 mg IV 8 hourly. Most common use is the cefotaxime 1 gram 8 hourly intravenously. The second one is the metronidazole 0.5 gram intravenously. Now the one another part in the treatment is the surgical care. The care of that perineal wound, the retained products, the pelvic abscess, the wound adhesions, electrolyte balance, the necrotizing fasciitis, and the management of the shock. For the surgical treatment, as we see, the first one is the perineal wound. The stitches of the perineal wound may have been removed to facilitate the drain of the pus and to relieve from the pain. The wound should be clean with the sweet bath at the several time and the it dressed with the antiseptic cream or the powder. After the infection is controlled, the secondary suture must be given on the lateral. Second one is the retained products. With the diameter of the 3 cm or less may be degenerated and left alone. Otherwise, the surgical evacuation after the antibiotic coverage for the 24 hours should be done to avoid the risk of further, that means the septicemia. Pelvic abscess. It should be drained by the colpotomy under the ultrasonography guidance. The wound dehiscence. Dehiscence of the episiotomy or the abdominal wound following the caesarean section is managed by the scrubbing of wound twice daily, debridement of all the necrotic tissues, and then closing the wound with secondary suture. It also gives the antimicrobials for the further culture and sensitivity. Laparotomy has got a limited indications, so there is need of the intravenous fluids. So maintain the electrolyte balance by the intravenous fluid along with the appropriate antibiotic therapy is control the peritonitis. So there is used proper IV fluids. Necrosis fasciitis. Now the necrotizing fasciitis is a rare but is a fatal complications of the wound infection. The risks are more in the diabetic, obese and hypertensive patient. The infection is caused by the hemolytic streptococcus and is often by the polymicrobial. The necrotic tissue is a significant pathology. So the treatment is wound scrubbing, debridement of all necrotic parts, and it's also effect of the antimicrobial agents. The management of the shock. Shock management. Fluid and electrolyte balance, respiratory support, the circulatory support, infection control, and the specific management as a hemolytic for the renal failure is essential in the surgical care for the purpural pyrexia. Now the second one, abnormal purpurium, is the subinvolution. You may know what is the involution. Involution means the uterus become a pelvic organ, that is, it becomes like a pre-pregnant state. It becomes a 60 gram after a 6 weeks. Is a normal involution. It involves in the pelvis. So what is the subinvolution? It means the impairment in the process of involution or the retarded, means a slow growth in that involution process. So what are the causes behind the grand multipara? Over-distension of the abdomen due to the multiparity or the oligohydramnios, the maternal ill health, caesarean section, uterine prolapse, retroversion, and the uterine fibroids are the causes of subinvolution. The aggravating factors for that subinvolution are retained product of conception and the uterine sepsis. Signs and symptoms of that subinvolutions are the abnormal local discharge. It may be excessive or the prolonged. Uterine bleeding is also excessive or the irregular, and the cramping abdominal pain. While in the signs, the height of the uterus is greater than the particular day of the purpurium, and the uterus feels a soft and the bogey. Then what the management required for the subinvolution? The antibiotic therapy is required.